Okay, time to catch up on the NASCAR scene. And, man, NASCAR, you couldn't have asked for a better way to come back from a two-week break with what they did Sunday night at Richmond. Welcome in Josh Harris, president of Darlington Raceway. Were you on hand, sir, at Richmond Sunday night?
I was in Richmond on Sunday, I hate to say it, but I left just a little too early. I had to get out of there, but I was listening to our friends at MRN make the call and then pulled up on my phone once all the action started happening.
Okay, what's your professional take on what went down?
Well, it was exciting for sure. Gives us promoters something to talk about, and we'll leave the any penalties to come in the capable hands of the NASCAR officials. But certainly a wild ending there. I think that race ended up having a number of storylines, from the tires that Goodyear brought with the option tires, which performed great on the short track, to Austin Dillon being a surprise contender throughout that race and throughout the weekend, all the way up to the point of leading almost to the white flag before there was another caution. And then obviously you had the excitement there in overtime, which led to the crash with Joey Logano and then Denny Hamlin, and Austin ultimately crossing the line and taking the checkered flag. So I'm curious, just as anyone, to see what may happen. There have been obviously a lot of discussion on all sides of this. I think it's a tough position for NASCAR to be in, to see how they potentially rule on any penalties that would come out of this. But I understand both sides. I understand where Austin's coming from. I can't say that I would make the same move if I were behind the wheel, but I've never been in that position. So, it's all on the line. He did what he thought he had to do, and we'll see what happens next.
Well, I tell you, justice can be served in NASCAR if a race runs long enough, because he was cruising to a win. He was on his way to a win when there was a crash in front of him, no fault on him, that forced the overtime. And then you had the finish. And, I mean, have you ever seen, in all your years of watching it, have you ever seen a situation where a guy catches up to the guy in front of him and takes him out? At the same time, you know, the guy behind him is passing him on the low side, and he's able to recover from taking the first guy out, recover enough and has his wits about him enough to take out the other guy and go get the win. Maybe you do it to one guy, but to do it to two, I mean, that's very rare, isn't it?
Yeah, I can't recall that kind of situation happening. You know, all the instances that come to my mind in terms of contact, especially late in the race, going for a win, usually involve just two cars. You know, a lot of people point to what happened just a couple of years ago here at Darlington with Joey Logano and William Byron, and Joey getting in the, you know, some contact there with William to take the lead there. There's been a number of situations with that Denny has been involved with over the years where contact has been made. And But I can't tell you where I've seen what you said, like make contact with one guy and then turn around and make contact with another guy, all to get to the checkered flag first. You know, it was something. I think about Ross Chastain's move at Martinsville last year when he hauled the wall, and that to me was a unique situation, because he kind of went in there and sent it, but he didn't make contact with any other cars throughout that process. So it was a little bit different. He didn't go for the win, but it was a situation where, you know, we hadn't seen that before, and I can't tell you that I've seen where the driver just accelerated to the point that his only option is to run through the car in front of him, and then live with the circumstances and the results of what happened.
Hmm. Josh Harris, president of Darlington Raceway, with us on this Tuesday. And Josh, you know, you referenced, and I think it's a really interesting comparison, Ross Chastain and how NASCAR sort of tried to legislate that. I'm in the camp that if you're going to tell Austin Dillon that the playoffs are everything, NASCAR has made itself just like every other stick and ball sport that the playoffs are the only thing that matter. The sponsors have basically told him, you've got to get into the playoffs. I don't know how you can penalize him then at this point in time for doing something to qualify for the playoffs, because that was the only way he was going to get in. If they were to, and I don't think they'll take the win away from him, but if they were to go that harshly, I mean, what message would that be sending to the drivers?
You know, like you said, it's a tough position to be in. I think in listening to feedback from all parts of the industry, from drivers to team and crew chief, I think from a driver perspective, if they were to take away playoff eligibility from Austin based on his actions, I think all of your drivers would understand, okay, we might have a solid black and white line, but we've got a pretty defined line of what is acceptable and not acceptable on the track in terms of making contact. I can't speak from experience on that, but I think just in listening to commentary from others, that this would help maybe create a little clarity, although it's still going to be a judgment call on NASCAR's part ultimately to officiate the race. So if there is no penalty, if there is no playoff, you know, penalty for Austin, I think it opens up the door for this kind of, you know, it could signal to the drivers that making very aggressive contact and winning at all costs is okay. And I don't know that the playoff format was NASCAR's intent, was win at any cost whatsoever to secure the playoff. I think it was, the intent is to reward wins. But certainly when it's winning, you're in and you're 32nd or 30th in points coming in, that really is your only option. Again, I hear what Austin's saying when he says he did what he had to do.
Mm-hmm. Well, with that being said, and I think you're probably right, if NASCAR wanted to send a harsh message to the garage, that'd be the way to do it. But wouldn't it be fairer, if that's the case, for them to say, moving forward, what we saw at Richmond will not be tolerated? Because I don't think there's a rule on the books presently that if you wreck out the guy in front of you, you're going to have your win removed, right? So, I mean, it would almost be harshly unfair to penalize Austin Dillon to that point right now, wouldn't it? Now, if you make the statement now, hey, guys, going into Michigan and moving forward, if we see this again in the next year on down the road, then we'll start taking wins and playoff points away. I mean, wouldn't that be the fairer way to handle it?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's certainly an option that could be on the table. And I don't know the specific wording in the rule book, but listening to Denny Hamlin's podcast, he did reference a portion of the rule book that essentially, and don't quote me specific on this, but it's mm-hmm. essentially that for aggressive driving or actions that NASCAR deems to be unsafe, they can, you know, penalize either during the race, at, you know, immediately after the race, or, you know, even further after the race. So I think that potentially could open up the opportunity, if they choose to go with a harsher penalty, to try and make an example. But I think it's certainly within the realm of possibility that they could say, hey, you know, this is the line, this is no longer allowed. I do think if that were the case, you may hear some drivers, you know, someone's going to be upset with the results of whatever comes out. So I think it's just a matter of who that's going to be. And I think we're going to, it sounds like, I don't think I saw anything come out today. So
no.
It may be sometime tomorrow before we find out if anything is going to happen.
Listening to your description of that, it brought up an interesting point. I think it's something NASCAR is going to have a difficult time trying to legislate, because aggressive driving, dangerous driving at Richmond and Bristol is entirely different than it is at Daytona and Talladega, right?
Yeah, it certainly is. And the higher speed tracks certainly bring in a different level of safety concern. I think NASCAR has been pretty consistent, at least within the last couple of years, on drivers getting into the right rear of another vehicle and turning them into the wall. So that part of what happened in this whole thing is what I'm curious to see how they rule on. And then you also have the other part that I think is probably going to get some attention is after the race on pit road. There's some footage out there of Joey coming down pit road and kind of revving his engine, spinning his tires a little as he passed by some of the three pit crew and other people out there. So I think that's a safety issue on pit road that they will also probably address with Joey as a result of all this.
Mm. You know, launching all this, you touched on it at the very beginning, the option tire. The first I heard about it was during the race. Now, maybe I was oblivious to the conversation, but, like, how long has that been in the works? Why did they unveil it at Richmond? What does it all mean? Will they continue to do this at other races?
Yeah, I think just to kind of take a step back, this was a they brought these two tires to North Wilkesboro for the All-Star race back in May, and it was an option. But the All-Star race, you know, it's a smaller field, a shorter race. It didn't quite have the impact that they were thinking, but I think they saw enough to say, let's go test this at a short track outside of the playoffs and get a barometer. All the teams agreed. They were on board with it. I think everyone has pointed to the tires being the area that we need to work in to try to improve the short track racing. And so they brought this softer, essentially the red tire, the option tire was a softer compound that would wear out quicker than the normal tire, but it would run a little faster, but you'd have to change tires, you know, sooner than on the regular prime tire, the yellow tire. So created some interesting strategy, and you saw it really early in the race when Daniel Suarez was one of the first to put those tires on. And he went from about 18th or 19th and drove all the way to first, won stage one. And I think that really showed that these softer compound tire, whether it's a mix of the two tires coming to future short tracks, or potentially even letting that softer tire be the primary tire for short tracks in the future, I think NASCAR and Goodyear and the teams got a lot of good data out of this race. I'm not sure if they'll move forward with potentially, you know, looking at the next short track on the schedule, which would be Martinsville in the playoffs, or if this is something planning for next year, potentially even for the championship race at Phoenix. So I'm curious to see what happens. I think they're going to do a little more work testing, get some feedback, but certainly it helped improve the racing on Sunday night at Richmond, and I think it's a really good step forward for the sport.
Yeah, I agree with you. I'm sitting here thinking, why don't they do this for every track? And it adds to the strategy, it adds to the race planning, it gives the fans something else to chew on and think about. I think it's a great idea. I think maybe they've stumbled onto something here that could be really good.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think this is something you see in some other forms of motorsports. I'm pretty sure Indy does a variation of this. I know F1 has, you know, sometimes two or three different tire compounds available to teams during the race. So it does create another interesting level of strategy on a car that we now run that is so closely built, and the cars are so much alike that this is another way that teams can differentiate their speed and how they run a full 400 mile or 500 mile or lap race. So I'm encouraged by it, and I think we will see this again in some form or fashion. Just not sure if it'll be later this year with the playoffs approaching or if it's something they're working on for 2025.
All right. I imagine that for Michigan this weekend, then Daytona, and then you guys, the phones had to be hot on Monday after everything that went on. And I would imagine, you know, they don't like to have retribution on the really fast tracks, you know, 190, 200, which are coming up. But then there's yours. Now, not to say that you can't hit 165, 170, but I don't know. Do you look at Darlington for the retribution to take place?
Well, you know, I think that's an interesting point. I think Denny, if you look at Denny and Joey, have performed at a higher level over the course of the season than Austin. And I think just looking long term, Denny's got his eyes set on a championship. So I think any potential payback, retribution, whatever, is going to be a secondary priority for Denny compared to maximizing his opportunity to get his first championship. And I think this is a year where he's really got that opportunity. So it could happen. I think it's all about when these guys are near each other on the racetrack. And it always seems when something like this happens that the next race or an upcoming race, those cars end up being, you know, close in proximity. So we'll see. You know, certainly don't want to encourage anyone to retaliate to the point of anyone getting hurt. But these guys kind of take care of things on the racetrack. It's going to set up for some exciting racing at Darlington regardless, because now there's one less spot available to lock in that playoff field. And by the time we get here after Michigan and Daytona, it could be, you know, essentially one of those, you've got to win to get in, and we'll could create a really compelling race with the Southern 500.
Yeah.
Josh, let me help you out here. I've got the perfect billboard I want to see all around Florence County and the PD and the state of South Carolina. On one side of the billboard, pictures of Joey Logano and Denny Hamlin. On the other side of the billboard, you have Austin Dillon in Victory Lane. And the caption is, "Payback is a Darlington Stripe."
Oh.
And the phone number.
Man, we could sign you up.
No charge. No charge for that advice from your friends.
You are free to use that and go sell the place out.
There we go. Well, I will say it certainly did not hurt ticket sales on Monday coming out of the weekend. I think it's a good combination of a great race, very compelling ending, the drama, and then NASCAR being back after 2 weeks.
Yep.
We've got some good momentum going. So encouraging signs from a ticket sales standpoint. We still got a few available. So it's going to be here before we know it, and hopefully getting towards that fourth consecutive sellout.
DarlingtonRaceway.com. Correct?
That's right. DarlingtonRaceway.com, or give us a call at 866-459-RACE. We'll be happy to set you up with whatever package works. Families, military, first responders, we've got everything covered. Would love to have everybody here for Labor Day, Sunday night, September 1st.
Looking forward to it. Thank you so much. We'll talk to you next week.
Thanks, Josh.
Sounds good. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Okay, Josh Harris, great stuff.